Start it. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here, nigga. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team here, nigga. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team fucking here. I done kept it real from the jump. Living at my mama's house, we'd argue every month, nigga. I was trying to get it on my own.
Happy New Year's Eve, everybody. Back, another edition. Well, Scott's not back. Where are you, Scott? Seriously, man, where are you? Not answering my texts, phone calls. What's going on? Anyway, we're with an awesome guest today, Erin Laverone, right?
What's up? Yep, this is Erin Laverone. Here for visiting for the weekend, but moving back soon.
Yeah, so she's in town, and we kind of, how do we, oh, phone call. Who's calling me? Turn you off right now. Okay, so we met up. How do we meet? You messaged me on Facebook, on my business page, and she was inquiring whether I needed help at Train Life Fit, and go figure, as you guys all know, I'm starting an academy in March where I'm getting to train some wonderful coaches, helping them develop their own unique style of coaching people from the inside out. And so it was kind of like a really strange but divine time when she messaged me. I was like, oh, this is kind of perfect. I do need help. I have this program I'm offering. And she's like, all right, I'm coming into town. And she just happened to come into town. And the next thing you know, we met up and talked for a while. And now she's going to be part of the academy, which is super, super exciting. I'm stoked. Oh, Drake is still playing. What's up, Drake? Hold up, Drake. All right. Anyway, so she's getting to join us here in March. I'm super stoked about it. And Erin has a pretty extensive resume. I was looking at your resume earlier, and you've been like in fitness for forever, like since you were a little kid. So you were just like involved in sports, involved in every little thing. And when you got to Austin, it seems like you just jumped into studying exercise science, kinesiology. Jumping into the personal training world, and then you moved to California for a while, and you work for a company called Exos over there, and that's a wellness company, right? And now you're making your way back to Austin, your dream spot in Mueller. So tell us about what you're feeling about that.
Oh, I mean, it's a whole mix of emotions. I mean, I went back to California, and that's where I'm from. Had a little taste of the Bay Area grind, and being in the fitness business just wasn't a fan of the 14-hour workday and being exhausted and not being able to cook as much as I would like, not being able to work out as much as I would like. And I'm a big believer in practicing what you preach, and so I just felt I wasn't able to do that, and I wasn't able to live optimally and perform optimally. And so I decided, you know, look for some new opportunities. I love Austin. The Mueller area is my ideal area, and I'm hoping to move here in a couple months once I get regrounded back here and save up a little money again. Yeah. And just start pursuing my passion and rebuilding my network back here. So, yeah.
That's awesome. You know, it brings up a really important point, and that's, I think that everyone, well, most clients, if you're a personal trainer or your coach, most clients think that you're a Superman, that you just do everything because it's your job and it's easy. And it's like, it's kind of like their excuse. It's like, well, you're the coach. You're supposed to do that. And it's easy. And that's what you do. And you've been doing it for years and years. But it's cool to hear your side of it. And I want you to kind of fill in the readers, if you feel comfortable, like about how your lifestyle was in California, just like commuting and what it did to your body, your back. Like, it's not always that easy for a coach, and we have to make it an utmost priority, especially if you want to help you guys. You know, we have to be in our most prime state to help you. So why don't you tell us a little bit about what you went through?
Yeah, so when I moved to California, I initially didn't have a solid job lined up. I had 3 interviews at different places. Luckily for me, I ended up getting offers at all 3 and then took the job with Exos, which they're a fantastic company. I absolutely believe in their philosophy. It's great. They're big on movement, nutrition, recovery, and lifestyle behavior change and whatnot as well, kind of a lot like your program here. So I decided, you know, to try them out. And I got hired with them. went on to a 2-week vacation in Europe and came back. And so I had, right before I left, I rented a place on the kind of west side of the bay in Palo Alto area because I wanted to be close to where they told me I was working. I bike commuted previously for the 7 to 8 years before I moved there, and kind of firmly believe in that. I mean, I don't like sitting in a car. It does a lot of bad things to you. In addition, it's just kind of a waste of your time. Yeah. So I've always loved bike commuting, so I found a place that, I mean, as reasonable as you can get in California, that's about 8 miles from where I was supposed to work. And then when I got back, they told me, oh, you're actually working on the other side of the bay. And not at 8 a.m., but at 5:45 a.m. So, I'm an early person, so I was like, oh, I'll make it work. You know, I'll have to get up at 4:30, which is not my forte. I like 5, but 4:30 is not too bad, I guess. But yeah, I just ended up doing a 25-mile car commute, which in the morning at that time is not terrible. It's 25 minutes, you know. Got to listen to a lot of podcasts, some of the well-being podcasts, and whatnot. So in the morning, it's not terrible, but, you know, coming back, it doubles. Yeah. And then with barrier cost of living kind of being as ridiculous as it is, I had to pick up another job on top of the full-time job. So I would do 8 to 9 hours with Exos at Tesla. And then come home, walk the dog, immediately hop back in the car for another 20 minutes drive to Stanford, train for 2 to 3 hours, and then be stuck in the car for another 30, 40 minutes back. So I would be gone from about 5:15 a.m., get to work at 5:45 at the first job, come home, walk the dog, and then I wouldn't get home from Stanford until about 7 p.m. And then it was literally eat, walk the dog, shower, sleep, and do it again 5 days in a row. And for the first time in my life, I had never been able to understand this before, but couldn't understand people who just kind of grind, and didn't like their job and didn't like waking up in the morning, weren't excited. And I was kind of getting to that point. Like we were just talking about before we started this, my back's like killing me, my hips and ankles. I had worked so hard in the year and a half before this to get them, you know, mobile and whatnot. I've got some previous injuries from playing basketball growing up and some running and whatnot, and worked really hard over the last year and a half before I moved there to get them back in, you know, better shape. And it's unfortunately, even though I'm in this business, it's tough to do when you're working those long hours. And on top of that, a lot of clients I know don't realize this, but we spend all day motivating y'all. And then, you know, it's not an endless commodity. It is hard to motivate ourselves at the end of the day. Yeah. So I know I do believe in practicing what I preach and do try to get in, you know, at least, you know, 15, 30 minutes or whatever I can get here or there. But going from having a prime schedule and working out 2 to 2.5 hours a day and focusing on myself to working and being on the road, you know, 15 hours a day and getting maybe 30 minutes for myself was not ideal. So unfortunately, even though I would have liked to spend more time in California with Exos, I decided to make the switch so I can be a better example myself and just feel better myself, perform better myself, because then I can reach out to people better as well.
That's awesome.
That's super awesome. So it brings me to my next question. Like, we were just listening to a podcast with Tim Ferriss and Tony Robbins, and they're talking about morning rituals. So I'm curious. I know in California it was like a different game.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's nuts. And I know in San Francisco, at least from what I can gather, you can tell me how it is, but the hustle and bustle there is pretty freaking nuts. And it's hard to get from place to place because you always have people in your way, so to speak. And it sounds like a terrible thing, but it's the harsh reality of being in a city like that. But yeah, you can tell us like what your rituals were in Cali, but what are the rituals that you like firmly believe in that really set your day and like prime you to succeed?
Yeah.
Like, what helps you?
So my like optimal schedule, which I was able to get to, you know, about 8 months before I left Austin, was wake up at 6 a.m., you know, kind of lay in bed for just like 10 minutes, take some deep breaths, think about the day ahead. Obviously use the restroom, brush the teeth. and then just kind of take a slow, you know, 30 minutes is kind of ideal. Have a little breakfast. I'm an oatmeal person. I'm actually trying to break that, trying to get into the eggs and veggies. And I've been doing that over the last year or so, although it's been hard since I've been back to California. But yeah, I think for probably 5 or 6 years, I was oatmeal probably 360 out of 365 days a year for breakfast. Oatmeal with, you know, berries and some protein and nuts. Convenience, and I honestly just love it. And it just worked well with me because I'm a morning worker outer, ideally. So yeah, I would do the breakfast. I would take the dog for a 25, 30 minute walk. And then I'd bike to the gym and I'd literally work out for an hour and a half to 2 hours. This is when I was still in Austin. It was awesome. I'd bike back home. I lived a mile from the gym, shower, and then I'd be on the road or back to the gym next to me for clients by 10:30, 11 a.m. and would work till about 6. And that was freaking awesome. Then I went to California and that all went down the hole. So rent's really cheap there. So I basically ended up with a room in a granny unit for 2.5 times the price of my own place here. No kitchen. There's a kitchen in the main house, which they let us use, but it's a little awkward to walk into someone else's house and family when they're like there and cook. And being up so early, it was almost a little too early for me to eat, especially because I wasn't working out in the morning now that I had to work that early. So honestly, I'd get up at 4:30, same thing, brush teeth, use the restroom, walk the dog for 15 minutes, and then be on the road by 5:15. Dressed and ready to go. I drive to work, get to work at 5:45, take the guys that I worked with over there through pre-shift movement prep. They were seat builders, so we took them through prep to get for kind of one-on-one 10-minute appointments with them. And so somewhere in that 2 to 3 hours before 9 a.m., once I finally felt that I was feeling hungry, I would grab some food, and at which case it wasn't my normal steel cutouts. It was the crappy packet oatmeal because that's all they had there. So it has definitely not been ideal. It's actually given me more appreciation, I guess, if I have to look at the good side of things, kind of for people who are in that rush and give me a better view and their view and whatnot that have to deal with that. So that's what I'm trying to take out of it, because it has been really rough and has not been ideal and has not been how I want to live. Even though the job was great, it's a good job, great company. It just wasn't allowing me to do what I wanted to do. And if I can't do what I want to do, I can't preach it. It's just, I can't do it. And then when I try to preach it, it makes me unhappy, because I'm not doing it myself. Yeah. If I can't practice it, I shouldn't be telling you to.
For sure.
So I felt that, and it was just getting on me, after, you know, a couple months. So I was like, I need to make a change. Something needs to happen. I need to find a better option. So yeah, just this opened up at the same time, so meant to be, I guess.
Yeah, I think that the whole integrity thing where you're preaching something and you know, like, deep down inside you're not able to do it to the full degree that you'd like to, and you're asking that of someone else. Like, I feel you. Like, when I first started this gym, there was no way I was doing everything that I'm asking them to do. It was more just like burnout, like pure burnout. And I'm assuming, and it sounds like you were like burned out, you know? So yeah, that's a big thing. And I wonder now that, like you just said, you have this now new appreciation for what people that go through that kind of lifestyle, you have this appreciation of what they go through. And so my question to you is, for these people that are going through that kind of lifestyle, like, what are like the three to five things that you could tell them to do in that instance? How can you help them optimize their life such that they can at least have some semblance of wellness throughout the day? And like, it could be 3 to 5 things that you think are the most important.
Well, one of the big things, especially because I was working long hours, we were just talking about this too. I'm a big believer in work-life balance and having a social life. That absolutely went non-existent. But more than a social life, I believe in is sleep. So it was like, I get off at 7 and yeah, I could go hang out with some friends if I want, but I was like, if I'm going to keep doing this grind, I've got to sleep. And I'm adamant. I took an exercise metabolism class in college, and ever since I took that and learned about how sleep affects metabolism,
yeah.
I'm adamant on 8 hours, you know, 7 minimum. Every once in a while, there are those days where you get 5 or 6, and I know I'm just the next day, I'm not up to par for sure.
What does sleep do to metabolism in your words? What does it do?
Yeah, I just remember the biggest thing. The biggest 3 things I remember from that class is, one, it's gonna slow down your metabolism. It's not gonna function as optimally. But the 2 biggest things that hit me more than metabolism, even though I was in a metabolism class, is that I don't remember the exact stats, but if you average less than 6 hours a night, the stat was you were 5 or 6 times, I think it was, more likely to have a heart attack in your life if you average less than 5 or 6, which in the city is very common. And if you average, another interesting one was, if you averaged more than 8, you're actually, I can't remember the number, so many times less productive in your day, for 2 reasons. One, you have less hours because you just slept through them.
Yeah, right.
And two, everything is kind of slowed down. Your metabolism slowed down. Your mental capacity is slowed down because you've started so much later and you're not on the schedule. So funny